What do you mean anymore? I've heard your stories, they were never quite true.
Thank you, Nadine. It's been 6 years since I stood up here, and this is the story from up until now. Now let me start. In late December 1983, my wife, my better half over here, Kate, and I returned from YWAM, and I came back with our family, specifically with a vision. And I shared that vision with the church that I was a part of at that time, and basically they didn't want a part of it. So in February 1984, I went and spoke with John Kirkpatrick, who had about a year before started up the Marston Community Church. And he was very, very encouraging and basically said that he would back us all the way. So we became a part of this fellowship in February 1984. When we arrived here, Rod Fleming and his wife Barb were already here. They had come from the church we had been in also, and also the workmen's were here. And maybe one or two others that are still here, but they were the ones who basically were here then. And we were soon joined by the Clark family, the McBride family, the Matthews, and the Irwins. And in May 1985, we had our first kids' camp at Riversdale Beach. And that set me for 25 years of ministry, all that time backed by this church. Over that time, I went through four pastors, lots and lots of elders, and the congregation turned over quite a bit, but there are many of you that are still here, that were here in that time. But this year there have been really big changes in our lives, Kate and I. We have been through a lot, and I have had to come to the place where I would evaluate where I was at. As I said, 6 years ago, we followed Frank and Doris Clark as they went to another fellowship, and they had been our staunchest supporters for 30-odd years. And we felt honour-bound to go with them and support them in what they were going to do. And then a year or two ago, Frank passed away, and Kate and I moved on to another fellowship with the pastor of the church we were at that time. He and I, between us, we decided that Carterton was the place to plant a new church, which we duly did, and that was called Solid Ground, and it is going today and being very successful down there. But I had come to this place this year where I had to reevaluate, and I went before the Lord and I prayed and I asked him what I should be doing, and he started taking me back in time. He brought me back to that day when I came here in February 1984, and the people that I met here and who sustained me for 33 years that I was a member of this fellowship. Now, in those 33 years, I saw so much. Nadine got born, and her sister, Lavana. I remember standing out in the back out here with Peter one day and encouraging him to put his hand up and for the pastorship of this fellowship, which he duly did. There's so many others. Paul. Now, when I look at the eldership who was up here the other day, Paul, I baptized at Riversdale Beach. Susie Winslade, I remember praying over her when she went to YWAM, which is also called Young Women After Men, and she came back with one, which was Ray. And then her sister Abby, I remember her being born as a child. And Rod Fleming over there, over 50 years ago, he baptized Kate and I. So you see, I have very deep roots in this fellowship. And when I was praying and asking God about our future, he encouraged me to come back here. And 6 weeks ago, we came through those doors. It was interesting. When I walked into this place, all the older people I know who were here when we left are still sitting in exactly the same chairs. It's true. So anyway, we came in, and they had a gentleman speaking here who had been out at the men's camp. And he spoke about the prodigal son. returning from sojourning in a foreign land and coming back to the family. And when I heard that, although my situation wasn't like his, I was in a fruitful place, but I knew that God was saying, come home. Come home. And then the following week, believe it or not, I think it was Mark Bridges spoke out of the book of Ephesians. And the book of Ephesians can be encapsulated into three things. There's a book by a guy called Watchman Nee called Sit, Walk, Stand. We are seated with Christ in high places. We are walking with him in truth and honesty and integrity. And we are standing for righteousness, faith and hope and Jesus. And I have decided with my wife that this is the place where we are going to stand from now on. This is the place where we are going to sit amongst you people. We are going to walk with you. And when our time comes, I want you people to usher us into glory. You're my family. You are those who I grew up with. Kate and I spent the best years of our life with you people. And those of you who have yet to actually cement yourself into this place, I want to give you a word of encouragement. You can find a home here. You know, fellowship, friendship, and family is not something that just arrives. It's something that we build, that we construct, like you construct a house. And if you feel a little bit out of it, you don't really feel a part, I want you to start building something. Go to somebody, ask them to your house for a meal. Ladies, I know my wife loves walking. Start up a walking group. I used to have we had in our house a house group, and they used to call it the Marston Community Church Fishing Club. Because a lot of the guys that went there were keen fishermen, and we used to go away for weekends and go fishing and things like that. So I just want to encourage you, build what you have, because this is the place where you can sit, walk, and stand. That's all I've got to say. Thank you. I think I was more than 5 minutes.
That's all right. It was a good 5 minutes. We love you.
We're glad you're back.
You know, glad to have you home.
I missed, and I told Nadine this, I missed her children growing up in those very early years.
Lots to catch up on, eh? You can come babysit whenever. Mate, owe it up to us. I don't know what you'll tell them, though. Awesome. Hey, we've just got two more to hear from today. I think one hasn't come back. Yep. Cool. So these two women are from our Connect group, and it's an honour to have them share today. So first I'm going to get up Jacinta. So would you come up, Jacinta? And she's got something to share from the Sunday when we did have Pastor Wes, who came and did a bit of ministry with them.
Good morning, everybody. I'm a little bit nervous, so just bear with me. I've written it all down in case I need to, I get too nervous and have to read off the paper. But I wanted to speak about the healing that I had down here several weeks ago. For those of you, many of you were here, but for those of you that were not here, Pastor Wes from Christchurch was here, I think, for the men's group or camp, and he was preaching the word that Sunday. And before he started, he said, is there anyone here who's, as a child, you know, felt a lot of fear and terror and often used to go and hide? And as an adult, some of the behaviours are really still running and hiding from problems. And, you know, straight away that connected with me and with my, you know, my childhood and what I'm like. But I didn't want to go up. And then Tracy put her hand up and I was like, oh, yay, I'll just stay here. And then he said, is there anybody else? And I knew I had to go up at that point. And when he was praying over me, I didn't really know what was happening. I was down there, but I felt a whole lot of things happening in my body. I felt like I was shaking. I felt like I had to breathe out. I felt that, you know, something was being released. I didn't really know what it was, but there was something definitely happening. Afterwards, I went and sat down, and I don't remember anything he said for the whole word that day, but when I got home and in the days following, I noticed that my mind was completely different. It was really clear, but it was almost blank, actually, and I struggled to describe what that was like. I think for me, I've always been a person with lots of thoughts in my mind, and for the first time, it was like there was nothing coming. And I think a lot of, for me as well, for a long time in my life, I've had quite negative thoughts or intrusive thoughts, mostly around how people have wronged me, not being able to let things go, thoughts about myself, kind of not being able to get into that place of forgiveness or letting things go. And I kind of just thought it was normal human behaviour, because I've studied psychology, I've worked therapeutically with people, I understand how the brain works, we have thoughts, we have to be mindful of those thoughts, we can change those thoughts, there's all these strategies, but no matter what I did, they still kept coming, and I guess I just accepted that was who I was, and that was part of my life, but it wasn't, and it was gone. And I can't explain that in psychology or anything else. And it was spiritual, and it had to be dealt with spiritually. And I afterwards, Wes also said, go and ask God, when you get home, ask God, when you came into agreement with this, or ask him to show you what actually happened. When you came into agreement with these thoughts about yourself or others or men. And so I did that, and straight away had this memory, which I've always remembered, but I was only 2 years old, and I knew it was significant, but I didn't know why. But it was very traumatic. It was a really traumatic experience. I was really frightened. I was really scared, and I knew that was the point at which something happened. I came in agreement with something. Something started oppressing me, and that has been there my entire life. And I had no clue. I had no idea. And, when I look back and I think about it, and now that it's not there, I'm so grateful that, it's just, it's amazing. But I was really sad about it, as well, because I thought, gosh, I was 2 years old. And for most of my life, I've had this, I've been living with this day to day when I didn't need to be. And, and it made me kind of realize two things. I think that, the enemy really does look for opportunities to steal from us. And we do have to be vigilant. And we, not just for ourselves, but for our children as well. But the other thing is that, God really wants to free us from oppression. And like the song, he is above all of that. He is all powerful. And, I almost didn't get up there. I almost didn't get up. It was, it was just this, okay, I'll just go. But, I think about all the times when I've been moved in the spirit and I haven't, I've been like, oh, I don't really want to do that. I don't want to go up there. I feel vulnerable. It's embarrassing. I'll just not, and I think about what have I missed out on? What has God had for me that I have said no to? And, I guess I just want to encourage you all, actually, if you feel moved in the spirit, then say yes. Because you just don't know what God has for you, and I sometimes think, I need to know what's happening, but I never know. Whenever God calls me, I don't feel ready. I never feel ready. But it's stepping out in trust. And that's all really. But I guess I just want to say thank you for those of you who were here and were also praying with me when that was happening. I heard your voices. I heard your voices. I was being released physically, spiritually from my soul, from my mind. And I think all of you praying together for me through Christ, made that happen. So I'm grateful for that. So thank you.
Isn't that awesome? The power of Jesus. And we just love Jacinta. She's so hungry for the Lord. She's a fighter out there in her world, standing for the things of the Lord and believing for things to happen in her life, and it's so exciting to watch her journey and be part of that. So well done, Jacinta. Thanks for sharing. And our final one today is Tash, another wonderful woman. Up you come, Tash. Let's welcome her up. This is very scary for some, But Tasha is someone who we've been getting to know as well, who's very new in her walk with the Lord, but again, so hungry, so loves the Lord, and is just ready to go deep, ready to go all in, and then you get asked to share. But yeah, let's hear what Tasha's got to share about what God's doing in her life.
I'm Tash. Forgive me, I'm not a very good talker. I didn't really know how to start this because my brain's sort of all over the place. So I try to keep it simple and to the point. Essentially, I didn't come from a Christian background. My childhood wasn't the healthiest, so a lot of abuse. I didn't have any good relationships with my parents. My dad wasn't a part of my life at all. I moved out of home at a young age because I just didn't feel I was where I needed to be, and try to start something for myself. But I knew deep down I took all the wrong paths, but we just lived them right. Eventually I got into a relationship which led to marriage. I got blessed with two beautiful children, but things were never great between us, and we separated. It was over 2 years ago now. But through all of this, I've just never felt that it was where I was supposed to be. I feel like I've always tried to, I feel like I'm full like of a lot of love, right? But I feel like it was never reciprocated, I guess is the right word. And then, you know, there's this yearning just for something, you know, you're like, there's got to be something. And I was always so restless and lost. And this past year has been really hard. It's brought up a lot of stuff for me. And I didn't know how to deal with the emotions that I was feeling. And it was just such a huge battle, and it was really weighing me down. Essentially, I didn't know how to deal with it, and I guess I just broke one day because we can't do things on our own, right? And I just asked God what I needed to do. And I was really surprised to get a response back. And he said that I needed to come to him. So, without a doubt, I knew that was a response. Like, whether I'm right or wrong, I don't know, but I just felt it was right. And I got up and I messaged my sister. And I asked her if she wanted to come to church with me. And the funny thing is, her response was yes straight away, and she was already in talks with April about coming. So MCC it was for us. I mean, if that's not a sign, right? It was very confronting for me coming into church, because I didn't know what to expect. And the feelings I was feeling were out of this world. It was very emotional, and it was emotions I've never felt before. What I've come to know in is the Spirit. The Lord has since pulled me out of my darkness and brought me to light in so many, and done so many things for me and helped me surrender a lot of my issues and to heal from them. He's shown me his mercy, grace, and love, and he's given me hope. And for the first time ever, I feel at peace, loved, and on the right path. I'm still learning so much, and I'm so thankful to have such a great family here. You guys are all so cool, and I can't wait to meet everyone else. But I'm so excited about this journey and where it takes me. Thank you.
Awesome. Didn't you do well? Yeah, come on, one more time. Thanks, Tash. I'm going to slowly bring the service to an end, but for those who don't know me, my name is Jermaine. I'm married to Nardine, and I just want to share a little something, and then I'll wrap it up. But one thing about, some of you may know my testimony. I grew up in a really dysfunctional home here in Masterton, but watched my mother become a Christian at the age of 11, so watched her life, my whole life, and out of watching her, I made a decision for myself a little over 10 years ago, and following Christ, I came to him, and in that very moment, I just knew God had a plan. He had a purpose. There was something for me. I knew that He loves me. I knew that He cherished me. His Word says that He died for me. I knew all of that because I had been reading the Word of God pretty much as a little kid and early stages of our teens, and I had a daughter at a real young age, Alexia. Some of you will know her. She's now 19 years old, and from the when me and her mother split up, I made a decision in myself that I'm going to be a present father. And so I was there, and there were times where I just felt really lost. I was moving from house to house, living in different places, but my whole thing as a man and as a father was I'm going to be present. I'm going to do everything that I can for Alexia. I'm going to drive to where I need to pick her up. I'll have her wherever I am. And as I started to make transition to knowing the things of God, I ended up moving here back in Masterton. And I knew at that point that it was going to be hard financially for me. I was working as a scaffolder and I was making a bit of money, but I had to commute every single day. And so therefore it was quite pricey back then, but not compared to what it is now. And so I had to have money each and every week to get over there and to have her, because I didn't want her to miss out as and having a father in her life. And at that time I was a new Christian, had given my life to Christ, and I was like, God, you just know what needs to happen. You just have to provide. And I tell you what, there were times where in the early stages I really wanted to tithe, and there were times in that time where I was like, oh, I'll put this money aside. I'll put it in my ashtray there in my car, and I'll take it to church, and I'll give, and I just really wanted to honor God that way. And because of that, God just always made a way for me to get to my daughter and to bring her back here. And one thing about Alexia you're going to have to know is that her parents, or her mother, is now married to a really good man, Remy, and they have a really good home, but they don't live a Christian life, right? And so she comes over to our place. She sees our home. She knows what it's like to honor one another. We pray together. We eat together. And then she goes back to her home, where things are so different. I wouldn't say it's extremely bad, but it's just not how we live a Christian life here in Masterton. And so she's tossed between two lives. And so she grows up and she sees this, and she's watching Nadine and I, our marriage, and the way we raise our boys, and the way we do life. We tell each other we love one another, and we're not afraid to say it. And we create this environment where Jesus reigns in our home. And one thing that she knows is she sees this, and she's noticing these things. And so she's older now, and you know she's 18, and on her 19th birthday, Nadine decided that, hey, we should buy her a Bible, because she'd been, you know, she's been up here and she's been prayed for and all that sort of stuff. And we're like, yeah, we'll do that. So we brought her this Bible, and it's a white one, a NIV. And the crazy thing is that from that very day, her head's been in the Bible constantly, and she's ringing me up on Saturday morning. She's like, Dad, what does this mean? What's the purpose of this book? Who wrote this? You know, all these sorts of questions going on in her head, because she's got her head in the Word of God, and she's hearing things about what's going on around the world, and she's seeing it, but then she looks at the Word and it's so different, isn't it? It's so different. It's so different to what she's reading and what she's knowing and what she now knows. And the crazy thing is that when I think of this, now, when I was having a conversation with her on FaceTime, and I was thinking, God, is this even real? I'm talking with my 19-year-old daughter, and she's asking me these questions. And I was just reminded how the consistency of a father was so in her, how I was so in her life, and God really honored that. And one thing I love about that is God can do anything. He can do anything. He can take our life and our situation, and He can turn it around. He can turn it around for good, can't He? And I tell you what, He's up to something with my daughter, with Alexia, and I'm so honored to be a part of that journey in her life. And He's just so good, isn't he? God's just so good. You know, the Bible says in John 3:16, it's my favorite verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believed in him will not perish but have eternal life. You know, I love those few words where it says, whoever. So that's an invitation to whoever. Whoever comes and believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. And maybe you're here and you come here and you're just thinking about life. You're thinking about your situation and it doesn't look right. You know, like Tash said, there's something missing. And I tell you, the missing component is God. He's the missing piece in our life. You know, he breathed his one and only, he's breathed the Spirit into us. And it's that connects with him. And if we can only tap into that, God, I know you've got a plan for me. And I tell you what, it's that draws us back to him. The missing piece is Jesus, people. It's Jesus. And the Bible says that whoever wants to come and believe in my name and believe in me will not perish but have eternal life. I tell you what, God can do anything. We've heard testimonies this morning. He can do anything, can't he, church? Come on, do you believe it? He can do anything. He can change a situation and turn it around for good, can't he? The Bible says that what the devil meant for evil, God turned it to be good. Amen? I'm telling you, he can do anything. And if there's anyone here who would like to know this Jesus that we know and ask him to come into your life today, I'm telling you that your life is going to change. He's the missing piece, people. He's the missing piece. And if all people could know this, if everyone in the world would know this and could know this, oh, how beautiful life would be. He's the missing piece. With every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here this morning and you're thinking about those things, some things that I've said, you know that Christ is the missing piece. You just waiting for an answer. You need something. I'm telling you that something is God. And Jesus made a way back to himself by dying on a cross over 2,000 years ago. And he won us back to himself. He won the victory over death, where the penalty of death, the penalty of sin was death. And we were in sin, but now we're free because we follow him, but because of what Jesus done. And today it's about Jesus. Maybe you're here and your heart's pounding right now. I'm telling you, that's Jesus speaking. Maybe you're here and you know you need Jesus. I'm telling you, Jesus wants you. He wants you so bad he gave up his life for you. What I'm going to do is I'm going to ask if there's anyone here, no one else is looking. All you have to do is raise your hand to acknowledge, man, I need Jesus in my life. My life is so messed up right now. It's so messy. But God can piece it all back together. And so if you're here and you're wanting Jesus to come into your life, come into your heart, and you want to acknowledge it, what I'm going to do is I'm going to count to three, and all you have to do is pop your hand up. I'm the only one who's looking. I see that hand. I haven't even counted to three. I see that hand. All right, here we go. One, two, three. If you're here and you need Jesus, I see that hand. Awesome. I see that hand in the middle, that hand down the back, those two hands down the back. Awesome. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I've seen those hands. I've seen those hands. You can put them down now. I see that hand. Thank you, Lord. What we're going to do now is we're gonna pray as a church together. We're going to pray the salvation prayer, the sinner's prayer. And all you have to do is repeat every word after me. And I can tell you what, in that very moment, you're accepting Jesus into your heart, into your life, and he'll come and he'll start working inside of you, amen? He'll start doing things that you just thought you could never do. And I'm telling you, if you only trust in Him and put your faith in Him, because this is the first step. It's a faith step. It's coming to the altar. It's coming to this time of life where we know that we don't have it all together, but we know the one that actually does. And so if we close our eyes and just repeat after me. Say, Father, today I come to you as a sinner in need of a Savior. And today I believe that you died for me. I believe that you rose 3 days later and you are alive. And you are sitting next to the Father in heaven. Come into my life today. Make your home in my heart today. Help me in this journey. I don't have it all together, but you do, Jesus. I acknowledge you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, church, can we put our hands together for those who gave their life to Christ? Can we stand to our feet? Up front here, if you are a new Christian this morning, congratulations. We do have a Bible here for you. We'd love for you to come forward and receive it from Nardine here. Let's just dim the lights, please, Dan. What we're going to do is we're just going to open up the altar. If you need anything from God this morning, why don't you make your way forward right now? It doesn't matter what the situation is. It doesn't matter how big it is, how small it is. If you want something from God today, if you need healing, if you've got some financial struggles going on, I tell you what, if we just only commit these things to God, He'll come and do His thing. So if you're here and you need something, the team are going to worship. We're going to worship. And if you need something from God, why don't you come forward? Amen? Amen.
If you curse me, I will bless you. If you hurt me, I will forgive. And if you hate me, then I will love you. I choose the Jesus way. And if you're helpless, I will defend you. And if you're burdened, I'll share the weight. And if you're hopeless, let me show you there's hope in the Jesus way. Follow Jesus, I follow Jesus. He bore my sin, I'll gladly bear His name. He is the treasure, He is the answer. I choose the Jesus way. And if you strike me, I will embrace you. And if you chain me, I'll sing His praise. And if you kill me, my home is heaven. For I choose the Jesus way. I follow
Lord, today we choose you. We thank you for those who have chosen you today, for those who have spoken about your goodness today. And we end this gathering by giving you all the glory. We give you the glory, Jesus. And again, we continue to put you first. So church, why don't you give God one more shout of praise, one more round of applause, and thank him for all he is. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Beautiful. What an awesome time of sharing and hearing from people, part of our family. Just a reminder, if you gave your life to Jesus today, we have a gift for you, a Bible, especially if you don't have one. And also there's a little booklet there that teaches you about what it is to be a Christian, and some information you can hand to us if you like. So if that's you, we'll hang around at the front for a bit. Please come and see us. We'd love to give that to you. Hang around for a cup of tea or coffee, which is through in the lounge. You can make it out there. Feel free to bring it back into here and spend some time fellowshipping.